For some reason, human beings find the story of the heroic last stand to be inspiring. The notion of knowing that there's no way that you're walking away from this fight alive, and yet still you find the strength and courage to go down swinging, even when the odds are so stacked against you that it's almost hilarious. Military history is replete with last stands. Some are even famous enough to be instantly recognizable. Thermopylae, Camarón, Pavlov's House, the Sarigarhi, the Alamo. As you may have guessed, the subject of today's Should This Be Canon episode is about a last stand. More accurately, it's a story inspired by a famous movie, which is itself based on a historical last stand. Now, I'm no comic book aficionado, but trust me when I say that this particular story is genuinely good, especially for a Star Wars comic that isn't adapting a movie or book. But is it good enough to be worth keeping as canon, especially when it has the potential to contradict another story set on the same planet? Personally, I think yes, and hopefully, by the time this video is over, I will have brought you around to my way of thinking as well. With the introductions out of the way, let's begin. Should Star Wars Empire to the Last Man be canon? While researching this comic in preparation for this episode, one of the things I find particularly fascinating about To the Last Man is that its creation begins with two completely inconsequential details from the original trilogy films. The first is this brief line of dialogue from the original film. Now, we know who Biggs is because we see him in the Battle of Yavin at the end of the first film. And in the special edition, we see even more of him. But who is the tank that Luke refers to? We assume that it's just another of his friends from Tatooine, but we don't see him at all in the film, and so we have no idea who he is. For all intents and purposes, his name is essentially nothing more than part of a throwaway line. The second detail is one of the many aliens seen in Jabba's palace in Return of the Jedi. Right there, the big leech-looking guy with the spear. So yeah, that's it. One line of dialogue and one brief cameo. And they would ultimately lead this comic to be brought into being. The universe is a weird and wonderful place, isn't it? It turns out Tank was just a nickname. The actual name of Luke's friend and the protagonist of this particular run of comics is Jannik Sunbur, born of Tatooine just as Luke and Biggs were. Also like his friends, young Jannik was eager to leave his dull, dusty homeworld far behind him and seek glamour and adventure among the stars. And so, like Biggs, he enlisted at the Imperial Academy in the hopes of becoming a fighter pilot. Unfortunately, Jannik Sunbur was a good pilot, but not good enough for the Empire. Rather than concede defeat and return home in shame, Jannik decided to stick it out. If he couldn't be a flyboy, he'd settle for being a ground pounder, and so joined the Imperial Army's infantry instead. We can presume that he also lost contact with Biggs at some point, as we know he didn't defect to the rebellion like Biggs would shortly before the events of the first film. While being an infantryman in a galactic empire is hardly a glamour posting, Jannik apparently made it to lieutenant in less than a year of service. Not bad. As to who or what the leech alien from Return of the Jedi is, that brings us to the plot. The story begins in the year 0 ABY, shortly after the Battle of Yavin. So far, the Empire has managed to successfully suppress all knowledge of the first Death Star's destruction. Understandable given the severe blow to morale and confidence that such a revelation would result in. And we find our hero, Lieutenant Sunbur, on the planet of Maradun, attached to a military escort for an Imperial supply convoy to a mining settlement. And we are quickly introduced to the rest of the cast. The stormtroopers and other low-ranking Imperials are basically nameless cannon fodder. The only other figures of importance to the story are Sunbur's three superior officers. In ascending order, Captain Gage, a snobbish, elitist, stuck-up ass, even by Imperial standards, who's made it to captain's rank purely on the basis of his high birth and family connections. Commander Frickett, who is essentially the same as Gage, only slightly less obnoxious and with a mustache. And General Ziering, a grizzled veteran who's quite impressed with the hard-working young lieutenant. Though given Sunbur's competition, that's not exactly a very difficult feat. The Imperials are suddenly ambushed by the natives, the Amani, but quickly see them off. The Imperials are puzzled by the sudden attack, as while warlike, the Amani mostly fight among themselves and have little regard for the doings of off-worlders. Still, with nothing else to do, they end up pushing on to the mining encampment, only to discover that the Amani have already been there. And not only have they massacred all of the miners, but they've stolen all their weapons and explosives. Not knowing when the aliens might attack again and wishing to give his men some rest after their long, hard march across jungle and savanna, General Ziering orders the men to establish a basic redoubt. As the mining camp is situated in front of a sheer cliff face, the Imperials build a simple barricade across the front of the mining camp, while positioning two of their juggernaut heavy assault vehicles on the flanks. The third juggernaut is backed up against the cliff itself to serve as fire support and as an ad hoc headquarters for the command staff. Commander Frickett and Captain Gage are confident in the security of their new position, but Lieutenant Sunbur, at the general's prodding, expresses some doubts. They don't know the enemy numbers, and chances are better than even that they'll be outnumbered. The Imperials are relatively few, and their defense will be stretched even thinner when they establish an outer perimeter tomorrow. Finally, while the sheer cliff at their back prevents the enemy from launching any attack from the rear, it also means that the Imperials will be unable to retreat. Unfortunately, things turn out even worse than Sunbur himself had feared. The cliffs might preclude a mass attack, but they fail to prevent a pair of Amani saboteurs from sneaking into the Imperial encampment from behind and using the stolen mining explosives to destroy one of the juggernauts, killing many Imperials and injuring General Ziering. What's worse, the Amani were smart enough to take out the Imperials' communications, so they can no longer call for reinforcements. Despite all this, Frickett and Gage are still confident of success, and the latter, rather smugly, orders Sunbur onto construction detail of the outer defenses of their new camp. Gage's obnoxious smugness evaporates a few panels later, however, when General Ziering, now with one less functioning eye than previously, orders him to take a patrol and scout out the area for signs of the enemy. Fortunately for the readers, Gage is almost immediately ambushed by the Amani. Unfortunately, he also survives the ambush when Lieutenant Sunbur mans one of the remaining Juggernaut's guns and drives the enemy away. But this is only a temporary reprieve, as the Amani then choose to reveal themselves in their true strength, and the Empire realizes just how dire their situation is. And thus begins the desperate fight for survival that will later be known as the Battle of Maradun. And so, with the plot set up, we now move on to details. As you may have guessed from my very brief descriptions at the very beginning, the four principal characters of this story are pretty one-note. Sunbur is the eager, gifted, hard-working junior officer. Gage and Frickett are the elitist, arrogant superiors who constantly put him down, while Ziering is the grizzled veteran who is the only one to actually recognize our hero's worth. This overly simplistic characterization is the same criticism that I leveled against Dawn of the Jedi. But for some reason, this flaw didn't bother me nearly as much in To the Last Man. And after giving some thought, I have a theory as to why. Ignoring that. First, To the Last Man has only three issues in which to tell its story, an excuse that the 15-issue Dawn of the Jedi does not have. But what really solidified my theory was the comparison of a long comic run versus a short comic book run to a novel versus a short story. Now, I'm a really big fan of pulp sword and sorcery. Conan the Barbarian, Solomon Kane, Fawford and the Grey Mouser, etc., and these were written almost always as short stories for pulp magazines. And as someone who has written several short stories of his own, and as someone who also posts his stories weekly on his website every Sunday, please check them out. Unless you have a better idea, you can zip it. I quickly realized that because a short story is so, well, short and doesn't have the time to develop its characters the way that a novel does, a short story writer has two overriding concerns. One, suck the reader into the story as quickly as possible and maintain suspension of disbelief throughout. And two, make the main character either likable or relatable enough that the reader will immediately become attached to them. If both of these qualifications are met, the reader is more likely to be forgiving of something like simplistic characterization. And while comic books are a more visual medium than text, I do believe that the same logic applies here. And I think To the Last Man accomplishes both of these goals pretty well. The story starts off showing us the might of the Empire, as again, nobody knows what really happened to the first Death Star. Then we transition from the pristine white boots of the stormtroopers on the parade ground to those same boots slogging through the mud. Then we meet Sunbur, down in the muck with his men, while his superiors, literally and figuratively, place themselves above the common fighting man. This obviously sets up Sunbur as the underdog for us to root for. This is emphasized a few pages later when one of the juggernauts gets stuck in the mud and needs to be towed out, and we see Sunbur once again in the muck helping his men, even after Gage reprimands him, firmly establishing his elitist snobbery and making it very clear to us, the reader, that even though the Imani are going to try and kill them all, Gage is the real antagonist here. Him and Frickett. Though the two have so much in common that Frickett seems entirely superfluous. Fortunately, it seems that the writers of the comic understood that, because at the very beginning of issue 2, where the Imani have now revealed themselves and the Imperials now see just how badly they're outnumbered, Frickett panics and launches an ill-considered attack on the enemy, which winds up getting himself and his men killed. And from that point on, the story becomes one big homage to the 1964 film Zulu, which is itself based on the historical events of the Battle of Rorke's Drift in 1879, when less than 200 British troops managed to hold out against up to 4,000 Zulu warriors. It still holds the record for the most Victoria Crosses awarded for a single action in British history. Now, I have no problem with this, as I love Zulu. I really think you should watch it if you have any interest in historical films, as it's generally one of the more accurate ones. And I really do enjoy homages to historical battles in fiction. Sunbur, of course, rises to the occasion and helps devise the plan for the mining camp's defense, earning himself a field promotion from General Ziering to captain, much to Gage's annoyance, but screw him. And the Imperials literally dig in to await the enemy attack. For the most part, the action is depicted very well, if not creatively, and the Imani do come off as genuinely threatening. Though I do understand if you find it hard to find something that looks like a planarian flatworm particularly intimidating. But hey, it's just like the Force. It's all part of the suspension of disbelief when it comes to Star Wars. However, I will admit that the homage to Zulu really does undercut the Imani a bit. Yes, the Imani charge is genuinely intimidating, and they do temporarily overrun the Imperial position, but this is again undercut by the fact that we see the Imani use more subtle and arguably more effective tactics earlier in the story. The initial ambush in the jungle, rigging the juggernaut to explode, standing just outside of blaster range in order to lure Frickett into their ambush. Clearly the Imani are capable of using complex tactics, but then this is all thrown out the window in favor of a head-on charge, and they just keep throwing themselves into hails of blaster fire. Then again, it's not like this is an entirely ineffective tactic. I mean, just look at how the Chinese performed in the Korean War in the 1950s. Most of them didn't even have guns, or even shoes, and yet they still overwhelmed the US and United Nations forces through sheer weight of numbers. And besides that, we are informed in issue 1 that Imani warfare, or Takatal, is highly ritualized, so perhaps this is just part of the process. Anyway, at first, Sunbur's plan seems to be working. The Imperials have set up 3 layers of defensive fire, the barricade surrounding the mining camp, and 2 layers of trenches, the inner one commanded by Captain Gage, while the outer one is commanded by Sunbur himself. The Imani charge, the Imperials gun them down wave after wave. After a while, when their ammo runs low and the aliens are too close for comfort, Sunbur and his men throw thermal detonators into the front ranks of the Imani, buying themselves the opportunity for an orderly retreat under covering fire from Gage's men in the second trench. At least, that was supposed to be the plan, but just as Sunbur's men prepare to withdraw, Gage proves himself to be a useless coward, panics, and pulls the men in the second trench back to the redoubt prematurely, leaving Sunbur and his men high and dry. Fortunately, the lieutenant thinks quickly, and seeing the Imani march by the juggernaut that Frickett took with him on his ill-advised sortie, uses one of the last thermal detonators to cause a massive explosion, buying his men their window of opportunity to safely withdraw to the second trench. Gage spends the rest of the battle huddled in a corner somewhere. I like to imagine him repeatedly soiling himself as he does. I was a Star Wars fan for many years before I was a 40K fan. And as I reread this comic in preparation for this video, I found myself wishing that the Galactic Empire had commissars. Curiosity spurred me to do some research, and it turns out that under Article 99 of the U.S. Military Code of Justice, Gage's cowardice would qualify as misbehavior in the face of the enemy, a crime that is punishable by death. Only whereas the U.S. military would have Gage put on trial and then executed, the commissar would have just shot him the instant he turned to run. Well, we can only hope. Granted, the Galactic Empire has the Internal Security Bureau, but they don't really appear that much in many Star Wars stories. Oh well. The Imani continue to throw themselves at the enemy, and the Imperials are eventually forced back to their final line of defense. And though the Imperials inflict hideous casualties on the attacking aliens, the Imani manage to take their fair share of kills as well, most notably General Ziering, who lasts long enough only to promote Sunbur again to the rank of commander before passing on. At last, after what seems an interminable period of time, the battle ends, and to the surprise of the surviving Imperials, the Imani come to offer peace terms. It turns out that as they were marching through the jungle in Issue 1, the Imperials had inadvertently crossed the boundaries of the tribe's territory, thus making them fair game for the Imani to attack in ritual war. But the Imperials have put on such a good show that the Imani are willing to treat with them. And as part of the treaty, the Imani leader promises Sunbur that any captives that his tribe takes in future Takatals will be given over to the Empire as slaves. Now, the Empire, as we all know, is always in need of slaves, and so Imperial High Command quickly ratifies the treaty between Sunbur and the Imani chieftain, and the Empire would later make identical treaties with all the other Imani tribes of Maradun. But alas, the ending isn't all sunshine and rainbows for our hero. While Sunbur does receive a commendation for his leadership in the battle and his settlement with the Imani, we are firmly reminded that the Empire is still the bad guy when the Board of Officers refuses to acknowledge Ziering's field promotions of Sunbur, first to captain, then commander, as there was no other officer that was willing to ratify it. Because, of course, Captain Gage was the only other officer to survive the battle, and the last man in the galaxy who would want to see his hated subordinate promoted over him. Sunbur is more than a little miffed that he's been busted back down to lieutenant, but at the end of the day, he's a dutiful soldier, and he will continue to serve the Empire loyally. For indeed, as the story itself tells us, duty is sacrifice, and sometimes sacrifice is its own reward. Huh, now that you mention it, it does kind of look like a Soviet Union-era poster. So, should Star Wars to the Last Man be canon? As I gave away at the beginning of the video, yes. The characters are overly simplistic, but for a comic run that's only 3 issues, I think this is still a pretty good story. The biggest concern here is that if To the Last Man is canon, does it risk contradicting the plotline of the Star Wars The Clone Wars episodes Jedi Crash and Defenders of Peace? After all, both stories take place on Maradun, and yet in the latter, there are no Imani to speak of. Instead, we have the mostly pacifistic Lerman. Fortunately, I think there is a loophole here. First, we know that the Lerman aren't native to Maradun. Second, according to Star Wars, The New Essential Guide to Alien Species, the Imani live almost exclusively in the jungle regions, with the grasslands serving as a border zone between the tribes and their various territories. Since the Lerman live exclusively on the grasslands, and all the important events of the 2 episodes in question take place there, it makes sense that the Imani would not get themselves involved. Keeping that in mind, I see no significant reason why To the Last Man shouldn't be included as canon. But what do you think? Let me know in the comments down below. Coming up next, the Adeptus Mechanicus Part 2 and Tales from the Mos Eisley Cantina. Until then...